1 John 3:11. In this I pray, that your love may abound still more in your knowledge and all discernment, that ye may approve the things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense until the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God.
That's the word of God for the people of God.
Praise be to God.
Praise be to God indeed. We'll have just a little humor today. So far today, I'm doing all right. I have not gossiped. I have not lost my temper. Been greedy, grumpy, nasty, selfish, or self-indulgent. I have not whined, complained, cursed, or eaten any chocolate. I have charged nothing on my credit card. But I will be getting out of bed in a minute, and I think that I'll really need your help. You know, that's about the way life is. Philippians is considered one of the most spiritual and intimate of all loving letters read in the New Testament. Paul, he wrote this letter with spiritual passion to a congregation that was near and dear to his heart. Paul gave birth to the church at Philippi during his second missionary journey. Here's what I like. He opens the epistle and expresses his gratitude and appreciation for the partnership in ministry and assures them that what God starts, he will finish. I think I'm glad no one told me this when I came, but I think when I came here, they thought the church was about finished. And when I came, I thought the church was just beginning. And you're not up to 100 yet, but look here. It's hotter than you know what, and look who's here. You got pretty good size. Thank you for coming. It took a lot to come out here today. And if you think it's hot for your city, come up here. The dog's the only one has a decent place to be. And then, here's the thing I love. The beautiful prayer of spiritual formation. It has four parts. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in what? Knowledge and discernment. Remember that. Knowledge and discernment. Do you get that real easy?
No.
What do you have to do to get knowledge?
Make mistakes.
Make mistakes is one way. You learn, not again. But what if we read the directions first? How many of you have ever put a bicycle together for your child and you get to number 14 and you find out you got to take every piece off to part 2 to put this one piece on? I know none of you all have ever done that, but I have. The second one, verse 10, that you may approve the things that are excellent. We're going to get into this. God expects excellence. People say, I'll just do enough to get by. I'm going to tell you a little secret. You're not going to get by. You might sneak a half-hearted attitude toward people here on earth, but you can't do it with God. It's either all or nothing. Number four, be filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. And we're going to talk about each one of these. Hey, the fruits of righteousness is nasty when you get down to it, because some of us, including me, might have a hard time getting through all of it. And I pray that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and discernment. That's the first one. He prays they'll grow. How do you get knowledge? You got to study. You got to read the directions. We have the singing bus driver over here. Does every bus operate the same? No. You must learn the procedures on every bus. Every bus. I don't care if it's made by the same people. Every bus. Placing your Bible under your pillow at night will not give you knowledge. You got to stick it under your eyes and your nose. True discernment means wise choices. And sometimes we as individuals know how God wants it to be done. I want you to know that. As a pastor, I know just how God wants it done. And then once I finish messing it up, he says, Pastor, why don't you do it right? Any of you ever had that experience? Boy, I sure have. Excellence. Excellence. What do you think of excellence? You think of a team performing to its total ability. I want to tell you what I think when you start praying and searching for excellence. You'll set your goal this high, but in the end you'll perform this high. You don't know how powerful you are. You guys do not know how powerful you are. You can touch someone that has never been touched by Jesus Christ just by the way you treat them. Not me. You. You might be the only tool that God uses to speak to someone. When I was in the motel in our little stay, I met an attorney from New York, I think New York. And I said, if you ever come down and you want to meet some of the people in Boone County, just let me know. I got a text. I thought, you know, most people, they take your pen easily, do this, they do that. And she wrote and she said, I'd love to come down and visit and see you guys. I don't know if we're going through the northern panhandle, but we're going through the southern part of the state. Do you think there's a way we can meet together? We'll find a way. And she said, I love coming to church on Sundays and Mondays and seeing the kids, not me. The kids and your sermons are good. And she loved the kids. That made my heart jump. That your children has brought someone to YouTube that you got them. You won. They hit a home run. Do we have a $1,500,000 crew here working on the production of it? No. We just put it up. We just do it. I don't have any makeup people or anything. And, you know, I'll learn to give it that big smile. But that made my heart jump. Did that make me want to do more? Yes, it did. Yes, it did. That you may be sincere without offense to the day of Christ. sincere until the day of Christ. How many people are sincere, or they use, quote, Christianity as a crutch? I go to church. I do this, I do that. How many of them go to church and enjoy themselves? You know, if I didn't enjoy preaching and enjoy being here, I wouldn't be here today, I can tell you that right now. It feels like it's 400 degrees. But you know what? That's when you can appreciate a sermon. I hope I'm just going to make sure of that. But the fruit of the Spirit is, I want you to look at this, love. That shirt says it all. Treat people with kindness. I know somebody had to be thinking when they put that on. You never thought that'd be in a sermon, did you? We have to love people. We have to be joyful. My wife has been so joyful this week, I can't stand it. I even did something I said I'd never do. Go on a cruise. I'm going. She said she'd go with me. Long suffering. Long. What does that mean? I've had enough of you, Harry. You didn't look at me right the other day as you were leaving. I didn't know you were having a heart attack. You know, sometimes we're not long-suffering. Sometimes we give up on people before when they're just ready to change. People are not going to change till they want to change. And if they don't change, the bottom line is they didn't want to change. Did you want to come to church today? Yeah. Was it hot? Yes. Could you still be in air conditioning? Yes. But you sacrificed to be here today. I'm telling you. Kindness. We talked about that. Goodness. Being good to people. Instead of the guy coming too close to you like I know and blowing the horn, I could get out of his way. No, sometimes I just blow the horn. Faithfulness. Being faithful to God. If you're faithful to God, you're going to be faithful to your church. You're going to be faithful to your friends. You're going to be faithful, to even the enemy sometimes. I'm sure in my life, I know one thing. God will break me if I try not to be faithful. Which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. All the behaviors I just read are the behaviors exemplified by Jesus Christ while he was here on this earth. He walked the walk and talked the talk. He paid the price. Do you think we as Americans have really suffered over our religion? A little. Go overseas. Say I'm a Christian in certain places. You'll be drunk in the town on the back of a Jeep. And then I say, am I willing to be a voice of a martyr? I'm not sure. It's easy to say it while you're sitting here in church. It's another thing to say it when they're tying you to a Jeep. I want us to close. Hey, how do you like that? It's quicker than ever. I want us to close with our song, hymn number 514. And I want you to think about something. Do you know anyone around you that's not a Christian? Or a Christian who is not living? shoot.
Can I share something real quick?
Yes.
I just listened to this one, Caleb, yesterday. And the woman, I think her name's Kelly, but anyhow, she was saying how this guy had, he had something wrong and he couldn't talk, so he was writing things down about his life. And she said, wouldn't it be great if we could all, because we all have something in our life that we wish we could do better, or, you know, we messed up. And she said, wouldn't it be great if everybody could write down their flaws and things, and then you read that before you met that person, so you didn't judge them by what you saw today. You know, because they might be a goof today, but something might have happened earlier in the day. And she said, we need to all just look at each other the way God does. Because he sees the beauty in that drunk or that bad person or whoever. And she said, you know, you don't know people's...
You don't know where they've been that day.
No, and it's so easy to judge before you get to know them. And maybe if you would read what they wrote about themselves before, your judgment wouldn't be so crucial. Oh, and yeah. If you could look at it the way God does.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I just wanted to share that because it's really stuck in my mind the past couple days.
Well, that's something we need to do. That comes into kindness.
Well, that's when that you started reading all that. I thought, you know, that's perfect to share because we don't look at people the way God looks at them. There's no way.
It's like when you go in with your resume and you put all your faults on it.
Yes.
You put all your strengths. Is that not true?
Yep.
And one thing about God, when you come to him, he already knows your faults. All you have to do is confess them.
Mm-hmm. But if we could look at him like he did, then we would look at him in a better way instead of the judgmental way, easy way.
And I want to stop real quick, but I want to say this. When someone comes to Christ, don't judge them in the first week, please. That's like feeding a steak to a newborn baby. You wouldn't be silly enough to do that. Help them grow. Help them become strong. Let us stand and sing. Be merciful to me and provide me with your blessings.
No.
Help me to show love for others as you have shown love for me. Give to me your peace and blessings of good health, and provide me with the protection